Good evening and welcome to the June 3rd Board of Selectmen meeting. Let's begin with Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, so warrant to be signed. That hasn't been done by anybody yet. I think we should be there. And then we do have minutes of executive session on May 13th to be approved. I was absent at that meeting. Could I get a motion to approve those minutes?
So moved. Second.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Passes unanimously. And new business. Let's jump the agenda a bit here, and just some really exciting new business is that congratulations and thank you to Lieutenant Don Cudmore. On July 1st, 2013, he will become our new police chief. So first of all, congratulations and thank you very much for all your service. We are very lucky to have you leading the way. And
I appreciate it from the board.
Just really, it's a great transition, and thank you.
Thank you.
Right. Followed by the very exciting declaration of surplus property. I didn't want to do it after that. Come on. So, Mike, is this you?
Yes, very happy to see these air conditioners on this list now. We no longer need them. The mishmash of office chairs that you see in the second floor meeting room, that's like the graveyard. Anytime anybody gets a new chair, their old one goes in there. And so we're ready to get rid of those too.
Great. And are they going anywhere?
Nowhere in particular. No, well, they'll either be scrapped or we have to sell them at auction or seal bid sale.
That's what I can offer, Mr. Chairman, is we use propertyroom.com. They come to Georgetown once a month over to the PD, and I could certainly store them in the garage, and we could have a scheduled pickup with Mike's approval, and then all of those funds are returned directly to the general fund.
Okay, great, thank you.
That meets the qualifications of an auction sale. You can online it, which is far less expensive than hiring an auctioneer.
Should have did them over the weekend. We'd have made some money.
Entertain a motion to accept and approve this declaration of surplus personal property.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? No. Okay. Keon's request to extend hours of entertainment license on August 24th, 2013 for a wedding. State your name, please.
Alan Borver.
Great. So could you tell us a little bit about the nature of your request?
Yeah, I did give Janet a fact sheet. It's a wedding that's being held, and their Greek tradition is they dance till late in the evening, early hours in the morning, and I guess they're flying a band in from Canada. So we've told them, well, we only allow the drinking 5.5 hours, and they want to start at 5. It ends at 10:30. They'd like to continue dancing till 2 or 3. I told them we would do 2, and we would ask for 2. And again, there would be no alcohol served. I also told them as a stipulation, we would make them hire a police detail from 11 to 3 to make sure that, you know, we're just kind of keeping an eye on things.
So normal alcohol time, 5 to 10:30 in this case, 5.5 hours.
Yeah.
And the additional time
is for dancing. I don't know if they're going to come back and say, can we go 6 to 11:30 for the drinking, but I've already told them regardless, if they're going that late, they can't have anything after midnight, no matter what happens.
And what would be the normal time for you to shut down?
1 o'clock on that night.
So you're basically looking for
an extra hour.
An extra hour, and then the police detail will be there for an additional hour.
In addition, we're thinking 11 to 3.
As people exit the building.
Exactly. And that way, I just want to also make sure they're not running out that car after we shut the bars. So just to have eyes out.
Perfect. Okay. Great. So I'll open for discussion.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, if I might. My only concern would be the parking lot issue. Mm-hmm. People running out, grabbing a couple of drinks and coming back in. So, and the noise level at that time, an extra hour at night, just to make sure that there's a police officer there keeping an eye on and keeping the noise down. Because that's our biggest complaint. Not from you, but that could be potentially the two issues, drinking in the parking lot and a lot of noise when they leave. So
okay.
That'd be my only concern.
Okay. Anyone else?
Gary? So this is a function room. There won't be another bar open at the establishment?
There will be, but we don't allow them. When they're upstairs, we don't allow them to go downstairs.
A police detail will help police, with that.
Exactly.
Seems kind of hard, but
okay.
You do.
Yeah. Well, we also have managers that are watching this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So this is normal at a wedding that you have restricted hours and then.
Well, yeah. We always only. It's a 5.5 hour block. Any wedding. You know, in that time, we're giving them appetizers and usually a 3 or 4 course meal. So they're eating throughout the night.
Yeah.
But we don't want it any longer than that.
Okay.
Questions? I think it's a fair request, and I think you're putting all the precautions in place. I mean, we're looking at an extra hour. It's not anything unreasonable for that. You know, you're taking the necessary steps to mitigate any issues.
Mm-hmm. I agree. It seems to me you're being responsible with the alcohol still, and you're also taking the additional police detail step to ensure compliance and orderly exit. Any other comments?
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I frequent Keon's enough to know that they do a great job over there, not only during regular business hours for the restaurant, but the functions that I've attended. So very well maintained, very well run, and always a management presence there watching over what's going on. So just wanted to state that for the record.
Thank you.
Does this, if I may, does this fall within the state law of the normal opening hours? Or what's allowed, or any town bylaws?
I honestly have no clue.
Well, the reason for the request, it exceeds the entertainment license. The entertainment license only goes to
1 p.m.
1 o'clock.
The request is just for the entertainment license.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. So the other, let's say, place that's open will be closing at your normal time.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. The bar downstairs closes at normal time.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to extend the hours of entertainment license for Keon's specifically for August 24, 2013 only, for one extra hour to 2 a.m. for the purposes of a wedding.
I got a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Okay. Any more discussion? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
I'm going to abstain. You got enough votes. My wife works there now, so I don't need the vote.
Okay.
Thank you.
3 yes, 1 no, 1 abstain. All right. Congratulations.
Thank you very much for your time. I
hope
you
have a fantastic wedding. All right. And thanks for everything you do.
Thank you. Have a great night, everyone.
Thanks, Alan.
Congratulations.
Okay. We have a proclamation to read. This is for Duffy Bridges at the fire department. And whereas Forrest Duffy Bridges in 1969 entered service with the town of Georgetown Fire Department, Erie 4, and served 44 years. And whereas through his dedication in said department, he has held the positions of training officer, lieutenant, captain, and deputy chief. And whereas the town of Georgetown is extremely proud of and grateful to Forrest Duffy Bridges and his dedicated service to the town. Now, therefore, we, the board of Selectmen of the town of Georgetown, do hereby call upon all citizens to congratulate and honor Forrest Duffy Bridges, who has worked so hard to realize such great achievements. In witness hereof, we have unto set our hands and cause to be affixed to the official seal of the town and sign and signature. So Duffy, thank you very much for all your service and all your many years of helping us to stay safe. There's also a little celebration going on next door simultaneously today for
Erie 4, I believe.
at Erie Fort for also additional services, people who have been there, other service meritorious awards.
Well, they did that.
Yeah, we did that.
Two weeks ago.
Sorry, I missed that. I'm off by 2 weeks. Got it.
Yeah, that one.
And actually, I think maybe next time I would probably want to read that out too, in terms of all those awards of years of service. And I should buy a calendar. Okay. Okay, just in terms of correspondence from the Alcohol Beverages Control Commission, they have taken additional steps to streamline the retail license approval process. I won't go into the details here, but I think it is something that, as part of our licensing responsibilities, it's good to be aware of in future in terms of any changes that have made.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Does this put any burden at all on us? I mean, as a town, do we now, or do we already contact the DOI, like if they're in back taxes with the town, or is this just state?
It's actually helping the ABCC, because they usually contact DOR, so they're making the applicant do it ahead of time and then get a certificate of good standing and turn that in with it, so that it doesn't get approved here, then go to ABCC, and then it ends up taking a couple months sometimes to get straightened out because there are issues with back taxes or something. So now they're going to have to get that ahead of time. And so it's making it, should shorten the process. It might make take longer for them and the applicant to get his.
Before they get to us.
Before they get to us. But when they get to us, they should have a certificate of good standing now. I think that's what they called it.
Yep.
Yeah. So it's,
it may actually be a little easier for you.
Yeah, it should be easier. It'll take that, well, even the process. Sometimes now it's going to them and then it's coming back and forth because right. they're trying to get it straightened out and it gets delayed. And this should speed it up a little bit.
Great.
Thank you.
Yeah, okay. I think we talked about this last time. I want to reiterate that party at the park, American Legion Park in Georgetown Residence, Sunday, June 9th, 3:30 to 6:30 p.m. There'll be free food, music, and games. Fun for the whole family. Bring a lawn chair and a beach towel. And that's sponsored by Georgetown Park and Rec. And thanks to them for bringing people out to this event. Questions on that? Okay. We then have the resignation of C. David Surface from the School Building Committee. Completely unacceptable, not going to happen. First of all, in addition to all his work he put in as chair, which is significant, he also put a lot of time into this committee. I know the chairs appreciate all the time you put into it, Dave, and thank you. We'll see who we can get to fill the shoes of yours there. But thanks, Dave, for all that work you put into it.
Thank you.
Dave, I appreciate. I really think your letter of resignation was tops.
Did you like that handwritten? It was beautiful. Wasn't
effective
it?
6/3/13, I resign.
That was good. Short and sweet.
No flies on you.
Right? And there's nothing to be read into that anyway. That I'm resigning. It's just a matter of placing somebody else from the Board of Selectmen on with the change in the chair. So
absolutely,
Nothing negative there at all. I did have the press call me to ask me today why I was resigning. I said, there's nothing there.
And because I'm married to the co-chair of that committee, I will not be assuming that position, so we will have to work with someone else on this board to get it there. And we'll get to that when we get to appointments and approvals. Okay, old business, Pond Street chain link fence removal. Pete's obviously not here. I believe, Mike, we talked about it. Maybe you can just give a quick summary of where we think we're at on that.
Yes, I'd be happy to. Pete, as a member of the fire department, is attending the Duffy Bridges going away party, retirement party. So he asked to be excused tonight. We did speak about the issue this afternoon. He estimates the cost of replacing all the replacing and repairing what's there of the guardrail to be over $50,000. He does not foresee having any available funding out of his current budget or within the additional funds that the chapter, I always get this mixed 90. Up, 90 funding. He said it would be pretty hard to prioritize placing some guardrails over paving somebody's street, in his mind. He did have a conversation. I haven't personally talked to CPC, the CPC chairman, but he did speak with Harry, and Harry told him that under the conservation, the protection of the pond, CPC money would be eligible. It would be eligible for CPC money. That process would culminate at next year's annual town meeting. So it would be this time next year until, actually, it'd be July 1st. No, I'll take that back, because CPC money is available the day after a town meeting. That would, if all goes well through CPC, then they could start the project this time next year.
Okay, great. And so I think, you know, I'm sure waiting can be a little frustrating to the residents who are concerned about this, but I do think, given the magnitude of the dollars and the fact that the town really needs to vote on their priorities on how they want to spend it, I think it's the best process. And again, I'm sure it's a little frustrating in terms of timeline, but we have our processes to follow. And I think, again, with that magnitude, the town should be able to allow to vote on it. I guess I'll just open any other comments, discussion on that at this point.
Just, I'd say, did that group have some sort of a chairperson that we might want to reach out to? Because I imagine with the way CPC is going forward now with the loan, that they're not going to have the funds. Some of the funds for the next few years are already spent. So it's going to probably be a tougher process, and someone of that group is probably going to have to somewhat spearhead it. So.
Actually, yeah, it's a different set of funds.
Right.
There's a recreation, conservation,
yes, I realize
historical.
That. Yes.
And the funds are from a different source, a different pile.
It kind of sounds like the ones for that are probably the ones that got used the most.
There's a zero balance almost over there. So whatever they collect for the year,
yeah,
and the match from the state. But your point's well taken, that they need to get on this now.
Yes.
To put it on the list to start. Right.
And CPC may be the best path, but it's not necessarily the only path. So, I mean, this could be brought using free, standard funds.
Your free cash.
Could be free cash. But either way, some advocacy and continued diligence would probably be required to move this forward. Obviously, there is time where it's coming. It would be next spring. Any comments, questions?
No, I. It was interesting. Mike had forwarded me a news article regarding a car that wrapped itself around the fence, and in the article it said that it performed exactly as engineered. So I don't know what to believe, if it's a safety issue or in terms of negative, or it's a safety issue in terms of positive, but I don't think we need to hit that hard tonight until we have a chance to dig deeper with Peter and maybe the CPC and let them deliberate if it's worthy of...
Well, just if I may, on what the chief said, the accidents in that area did involve a dog and a deer, which kind of, to me, shows that there probably isn't a place for them to go.
So yeah, and I think
it could be a negative also.
Right. Yep.
I mean, you can make the argument there's not many accidents. There are a lot. You know, it's not a high accident area. But I think that's part of what the town, you know, gets to decide when both sides are make their case as to if we prioritize the money. That's when people, you know, can make that case.
And crash data is based on traffic volume. So you'd have to do a definitive volume study to ensure that your crash and your traffic data match your volume. So there is a bit of a formula to that, too. That was just some data that we had compiled in the last 5 years of the area for you. Take a look at.
I did hear from Jack Moultrie. I didn't specifically talk to him about this, but I am going to call him back. He, Janet had forwarded me the information. He heard it. He heard I was looking for him all the way up in Maine. So I have his information. I am going to call him and talk to him about why the fence was put up in the first place. So we have a little more history and a little more background. But
Right, well, at this point, the direction is, it's an active discussion. It can be brought in front of town meeting, and should we get it there, the town can decide. Okay, next, food truck regulations, which will be followed by secondhand shop regulations. Lieutenant Cudmore, do you want to come up? Chief-elect?
Careful. Chief might be watching.
I don't know. That's why this guy said elect.
I don't know what to call him right now.
Lieutenant Cudmore until July 1st.
Still lieutenant.
Lieutenant Cud, please.
I'm in flux with everyone else.
You know.
You're a lame duck.
Sure that, wait for a text from the chief.
He watches it.
He's watching.
He watches at 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
Morning.
TBR. Oh, there you go, right? Still have to behave.
Lieutenant Cudmore.
Eyes on you, Lieutenant.
So, and actually, before we start the specifics on this, just a lesson in bylaws and regulations. Mike, can you just talk about, we obviously know what happens with the bylaw. Can you talk about what a selectman regulation is and how that could play a role here?
Yeah, there's a section in the compilation of our rules and regulations. Some are bylaws, some are rules. And there's a section for selectmen regulations, and that's where we would, that's what we're proposing that these become as a selectmen's regulation.
With a path for a bylaw, or?
No, it wouldn't be necessary for a bylaw. It'd just remain a regulation.
Local ordinance, is that what we call it?
Yeah. Well, they call, other places would call it an ordinance. The correct name is selectman's regulation.
Okay. So that's what's on the block tonight, potentially for a decision, or in the future, not tonight, as to whether we adopt the ordinance as the draft food truck ordinance as a selectman regulation. That's an option for us. So can I just say, do you have a question up front?
Well, it's sort of on what you're saying. So it sounds like, so where word bylaw is mentioned in here, that would in the future be changed to selectman regulation?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I just want, while you were on the subject. But.
Yeah. So Lieutenant Cudmore, you want to just talk us through this a little bit?
Well, I think I had spoken earlier to a couple of the members concerning the difference between the food truck ordinance and the new ice cream truck vending permit process that came out in February. So they've kind of melded together, but they are very separate.
Okay.
Because the I'll go with the ice cream truck vending first, because it falls into this particular item here. Back on February 15th, there was legislation adopted, whereas the cities and towns need to regulate a permitting process for ice cream vendors. Now, we have not had any requests this year. We've had requests in the past, but there was not this particular legislation in place. And what it is there's an actual permit that's issued to the person who's applied. It supposed to, this is a recommendation from Mass Chief's legal counsel, has the town seal on it. It gives the permitting authority as well as the vendor that has applied. There's an application that goes with it pursuant to Mass General Law 270. And someone applying for this particular permit would only be able to sell ice cream from a ice cream truck with an amber light, some motor vehicle regulations and so forth. The disqualifiers if you're a sex offender. And the law is quite broad actually for the disqualification of someone with a criminal record. It leaves it to the authority, whether it be the chief, to quote the exact language so that you're aware of it. It says, the definition of the permitting authority. The permitting authority is the chief of police or the board or officer having control of the police in any city or town. The permitting authority may also be a person authorized by the chief of police, the board, or an officer. So by osmosis, it's technically the board of selectmen, but certainly the chief of police can handle the permit. Like I said, there's not a high volume of them right now. The only people that would apply for the permit who would do business in Georgetown if they select to do business only in Georgetown, or somebody who resides in Georgetown. So if your residential address is in a community, you apply for that permit in your residential community. You get authority from your
permitting authority there, then you can go to various communities with this posted. If you do not live in Georgetown but want to do business in Georgetown, I'm sorry, if you live in Georgetown, you have Georgetown's permitting authority to get the permit. So basically, you can do either or.
And that's good, you're saying, in any town, once you have it from your issuing authority?
Yes.
So if they don't live in town, or if they're not going to be exclusively in town, was that the other mm-hmm. piece of it? Then it's a non-issue for us, right? Because they're going to get their license issued from someone else, wherever they live.
Let's see, I'll read it exactly. My service, there are two ways to obtain a permit, either by applying to the municipality where the applicant lives, or by applying to the municipality where the applicant plans to operate the ice cream truck. An applicant who obtains a permit in the municipality where he or she lives may operate without restriction in any other municipality. However, an applicant who obtains a permit in a particular municipality where he or she intends to operate is restricted to operate in that municipality.
Okay, gotcha. Okay.
So once they get a permit in their own community, they can go anywhere.
And the disqualifier in the law is that if you're a sex offender. You are not, that's a disqualifier for that permit. It doesn't mention felony convictions, it doesn't mention any other crime, it just mentions sex offender, because I think that was the premise of the law when they adopted it.
But the licensing authority would have the discretion to actually grant it if it was, if there were other.
Or deny it.
Or deny it, yeah, if
because
there were other.
Because it's so broad. I know that some of our largest cities and towns, I went to a meeting and they're actively engaged in that right now. We have not had any requests at this time in Georgetown. My only question was, would the town of Georgetown want the licensing authority, the permitting authority, through the police department or through the Board of Selectmen?
Okay, and you're saying that this is, even though it's close, it's separate from the food truck ordinance?
It is.
Truck.
So it's a separate. Because a lot of people are combining the both, and they're two very separate issues. Yeah. An ice cream truck is not a food truck. So we just have to be clear on that when we draft our food truck ordinance.
Well, my daughter would clearly tell you that ice cream is food, but accepting that. Comments or questions from the board regarding, I guess we'll start with the ice cream truck ordinance. We don't have that in front of us, but just right. In terms of discussion.
This just came out, and when we decided to do this, I figured we would combine them because people have called and had questions about them, and they're beginning to meld together. I just wanted to keep them separate.
And to clarify, Mike, would that be a selectman's regulation, or is that already have a different empowerment based on from the state?
I believe it's Mass General Law.
That's a Mass General Law.
So that's not a regulation for us. That would be more deciding whether we keep the responsibility or whether we appoint it to the chief of police.
Yes.
And the difficult part is the criminal check that's done. It's a Corey document, which is protected by privacy. So if the board were the permitting authority, the record would be run and kept at the PD, and then there would have to be information relayed concerning approval or denial through the chief's office so that record is kept secure and not in violation of Corey.
Okay. So at this point, we don't have to decide whether we agree with the ice cream truck piece because it's already in place. It's a matter of do we want the responsibility or do we want to designate it to
correct
the chief of police and or the chief can designate to someone else or the board can as well too, right?
The both, yeah. And what it would be is we put the town seal here and then the permitting authority would be the chief of police here and also on the application. These are draft documents that we would create. Very similar, I just created the draft documents for our solicitation bylaw, which I'm sure is pending with the AG's office. I had to create a permit. I had to put the seal on it. Someone's picture will be overlaid on it. Once they complete the process, that permit will be issued to the police department in the bylaw.
Okay.
So I think it's similar in that regard on the ice cream, not on the food because you need a committee and so forth here, but I think the solicitation bylaw and the ice cream truck vendor permit is very similar. And like I said, based on the volume, I think we can handle it.
Okay. So I'll open up for discussion. Anybody, whether you have comments on it or concerns about making a decision about it or?
Go ahead, Gary.
Just a question then. The food truck is the food truck and the ice cream is going to be separate. We can't combine them.
I don't believe so. And like I say, only because this is a Mass General Law that was enacted by the legislature. I don't know what the intent of this is here because there's health regulations and the fire department and that committee. And I don't know where that authority is derived from, whether there's denial or...
What I guess the difference being that the ice cream truck does just travel around and around, where the food truck that we're looking at is basically a stand still in one position
in
for the
park.
Day.
Yeah.
So that's
my belief too.
That's
why
the largest
light
difference that we're looking at. I mean, a guy may want to sell ice cream also at a...
What?
If the guy sells ice cream along with hot dogs, can he do that, I guess, is part of the...
Well, I think that you'll find that it allows for background checks for that very reason in here, too,
mm-hmm.
to get a food truck license.
And I suspect, and just speculating, that Massachusetts moved on this because of the high percentage of children that would frequent an ice cream truck versus a food truck, which could have children, but just, you know... High frequency of children for the ice cream truck.
So, right. So have we formally adopted that Mass General Law and regulation? Do we have to do that, or this just
the ice cream?
Yeah. Have we already done that formally?
No,
we don't have to, right, Mike?
It's an unfunded mandate from the state.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But we're allowed to charge a fee for the permit, so that's how they get around the unfunded.
Should we put something in our minutes though that we've adopted that, so that we can. It can be enforced, no?
I'll look into it, but I don't believe so.
No, just automatic. Okay.
Yeah.
Is the fee set by the state?
There is no fee associated with the actual regulation that was sent to us. There's no established fee.
So
I think that would be the bylaw.
But we can establish the fee.
We should be able to, otherwise it's an unfunded mandate.
And what process would we establish the fee by? Would that be a
Selectmen's regulation?
Selectmen's regulation. I've never. That's a term that's come up 9 times in the last 48 hours. I've never used it before. Okay, Phil.
Let's come over. Just a quick question regarding the quarry. So today, I just I'm not clear on if you guys do get a quarry report and there is a felony on that. Can that be communicated to this board or the specifics of the the findings?
That it's a problem.
So if you came up with a quarry report mm-hmm. and it came up with a felony other than a sex offender,
mm-hmm.
you would only be able to tell us that what? That it didn't come up clean? Or
based on the disqualifier of this statute, that if they're a registered sex offender, I'm sorry, if they've been convicted of a sex offense, that would, because they've signed the agreement concerning the criminal check. See, on the questionnaire, on the application itself, it says here, are there currently any sex offense charges pending against you? Are you or have you ever been a sex offender as defined by section 178C of chapter 6 of the general laws? They have to answer that question and then sign the ability to release that information if in fact they have. And
but if it's a non-sexual, you can't let us know what that felony conviction was.
I would not release it.
Right.
Under this particular permit. Maybe another venue, maybe there was a venue that we could go, but not under this particular permit.
In general, if we're trying to get an approval for any permit in town,
mm-hmm.
and we ask the police, or somebody does a quarry check, I guess my question, I'm just trying to make sure I understand where that quarry goes, who has access to the information on that, because if we, as a board, decide that this is the licensing authority, if we don't know what those felony convictions were, mm-hmm. or how long ago they were, or whatever, I think it would be very difficult for us to make that decision.
Right. When somebody allows for a criminal check to be done on themselves, they sign a release.
Yeah.
And when they sign that release, I have to do it when I work at the school to be a
right,
coach.
Right.
If anything comes up on that, I've signed the release saying, hey, whatever you find, I'm fair game. So the release for this particular permit is not a general release. It's these three questions that they've released on. But in the meeting I went to, they said that the licensing authority is a broad spectrum whether that permit will be denied, and that permit, though there'll be an appeal process to somebody if that permit's denied. So that's why it's kind of a slippery slope.
Can't we, Mr. Chairman, if I might, can we expand the scope of the quarry? In other words, if there's somebody who wants an ice cream truck and they've had mm-hmm. multiple B&Es and they've been convicted of those, do we want to ride around our neighborhoods? You know,
I don't think I would not be able to answer that question whether we would be allowed to expand the scope of this particular law under this particular chapter. It sounds logical, but again,
under 270.25. We couldn't deny him based on that, but we could deny him based on our own discretion.
If you had the information. I would have the information.
Would we get that information?
Not the felony conviction, no.
That's the point right there.
And that, we can't adopt a selectman's ordinance or selectman's rule or selectman's whatever it is.
Regulation.
Yeah, regulation that says if you want to operate an ice cream truck, you have to adhere to those rules plus these.
Yes.
Why can't we?
You can.
Because there you go, Phil. So we can say that we won't issue a license to anybody that has a felony conviction and they have to go through a query beyond this. Expand the scope.
That would be at the pleasure of the board.
Yeah, that's as the licensing authority. You know, if we were the licensing authority, then we would have information to everything, right? The whole quarry. But we couldn't deny him if we went just by this law on anything but sex offense.
Right.
Okay. So we could have a, not only do we have a food truck ordinance, we could have a ice cream truck ordinance.
Well, I'd suggest combining the two.
Yeah, maybe we should. Yeah, maybe we should. So that we do a full quarry on anybody that wants to have an ice cream truck.
Permitting, yeah, be the same.
Right. There's no law that says we can't make it tougher than the state law.
Right.
As a local ordinance.
Right.
We do every and everything else.
Right. Right.
So, the question now is,
As far as the background check, I'll just read this to you here. If I may, the permitting authority of the municipality where the applicant applies will determine whether to require a fee for conducting the requisite criminal background check. So there could be a fee associated with the criminal background check, like Mike said, the unfunded mandate portion of having to do this additional step.
Right.
So then the question at hand is, regarding the Mass General Law, is do...
Just one more. It says, based on the results of the investigation. So the investigation commences with regard to the permit request. Into the applicant's criminal history, the permitting authority will determine the applicant's eligibility. However, in no case will a permit be issued to a person who is a sex offender as defined by Mass General Law Chapter 6, Section 178.
Right. So that's saying that
sole disqualifier... is right. A sex offense.
Right. But
an investigation
like
could reveal
right.
that you've
exactly.
got criminal
liability
yeah.
based on some other.
Right.
Yeah.
Very similar to the solicitation
right,
bylaw.
Exactly.
We
yep.
And I know where Mr. Serfs is going is that did pass muster with town council concerning the background check once they signed the release concerning a solicitation permit.
Right.
It should all be.
It's awaiting AG approval, but it's there.
Yeah, these should all be in alignment.
Yep.
All of these. I mean,
this
no
here
way
just
we,
seems to give. In my opinion, gives sole disqualifier on the sex offender
right.
offense.
Yeah, but we could strengthen it up. And I think they should all be in alignment because, you know, to David's point, you know, we certainly don't want to have, you know, we when you did the mm-hmm. the solicitation law or regulation there, that statistically, the more of these mm-hmm. door-to-door solicitations we get, the more crime we get.
Correct.
So it could very well be the same thing for, you know, these food trucks situations and the ice cream trucks. So I you know, my two cents, I think they should all be very well aligned and
now what I had a question
similar
on
language.
Was with regard to the food the mobile food vendor committee. So is it approved by committee?
Yeah, see,
before we go to the combining piece here. So there is the first mm-hmm. question is there is a Mass General Law that allows someone to apply for an ice cream truck. And a decision by this board, I believe, needs to be made on who is the authority. To ultimately grant that license. Do we want to keep that as our board, or do we want to designate or empower our police chief or other to handle that? Because regardless of any regulations, which is going to take, I'm sure, a little time to put together, mm-hmm. that exists right now. And so we should make that decision so if someone comes to apply, we have the process.
In the way it was written up, they had to get a sign off of not the committee, the way I saw it, but someone from the boards, I believe it was.
Not for ice cream, though,
Gary. Not for ice cream.
We're talking ice cream.
For ice cream, anybody can apply. Per Mass General Law, we have to determine who are they coming to. Are they coming to us, or are they coming to the police chief? And
It didn't sound like we have that discretion from what.
I think we have to make that decision point,
yeah.
Correct?
Yeah. I'll let you take a look at this too. This is what I printed this morning.
Yeah, it's
facts and questions. Mr. Chairman, if I might, my suggestion would be to leave it with the Board of Selectmen for now, because ultimately we're going to want to tighten up with the ordinance. So, you know, why push it to the police department now while we're in the middle of getting everything done and aligning them with the food, you know, kind of making them side by side in this food.
You know what I can do? I can make copies of this packet. I'll send it to Mike electronically so he has a copy of this. And then the facts and questions there, as well as the vendor regulation. It's not that long. It's only 2 pages. And it basically, it deals with the investigation upon receipt of the application and the charging of a fee for that particular background check. And then section 5, this is the disqualifier. In no case, however, shall a permitting authority ever issue a permit to any person who's a sex offender.
Right. You know, the only other thing on this too is, as we're thinking about this, we can make the rules and regulations tougher for the people that are living in Georgetown applying for this permit, but that isn't necessarily true of the other communities that are issuing permits.
No.
They may say, hey, the only reason why we would ever deny anybody is for sex offender. Mm-hmm. Other stuff, we don't, you know, we'll just go by the state law.
We have a very limited scope.
Yeah, so it's only our own people and our own ice cream trucks in our own town.
What we're doing is, yeah, we're actually tightening the regulation for
our
own residents.
People, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, other communities could say, hey, we're just going to adopt the rule like that.
You have this hanging in your window from any other community you're
upset.
Right.
So we're just making it more difficult for our own people that live in town.
Good point.
There's a lot of people that live in town, so, right. You know.
No, I stand.
And again, we don't necessarily have to make it more difficult. It's an option. But I guess if we did do a selectman regulation, and if we had appointed the chief of police to do the approval, he would do it on one level, and then we'd have to do it on another level, which makes no sense. So, Dave, what you're saying a little bit is, hey, until we figure out if there's going to be a selectman's regulation under it, a second level of approval, we keep it with the board for now. And then if we decide we're not going to do that, then we can decide whether we'd rather have it with the chief of police, which would be my preference if there's no secondary approval needed.
Agreed. Now, with regard to a phone call from somebody who wants a permit next week, we have to act on it according to the regulation. So what would we do?
So
if somebody called tomorrow, CMR was enacted on February 15th. The calendar days.
That's problematic for us as a board.
Can you get the Corey back that quick?
Well, we can get Corey's instantaneously.
Okay.
That's the thing. The chief can approve these all day long.
Yeah.
We can only approve them once every 2 weeks.
Right. And so, by definition, if we have to be able to do it within 10 days,
we have to
use the police chief, because if they ask on a Tuesday after our Monday meeting, unless we do a special session, not that we're expecting dozens of these, but
no,
it might
be prepared.
It might make sense to do that, and then we can decide upon Selectman's regulation, if we do put one in place, what the impact of that is and what that means, because that 10-day would be hard for us sometimes to respond to.
Agreed.
How do we also hold a hearing for a applicant when we cannot release criminal record that they are a felon, and you know we can't deny him, we won't be able to state publicly why we deny him?
No, but when you write the regulation, we could say they need to it's required to have a release for everything, not just sex offender issue, right?
We can't disclose any public criminal record. I don't know if it's going to be problematic, but
right.
No, in the discussion you're having right now was problematic for the local police chiefs. Because it was, you know, when this was enacted, not having defined, you know, I mean, our solicitation bylaw is much more defined than this, as we just experienced.
Mm-hmm.
And this is kind of open and ambiguous with regard to that approval.
And I think, Mr. Chair, to David's point about, you know, other towns. I mean, you know, the other towns may just go with Plan A, you know, and if we're a little more stringent, then it becomes potentially problematic to some degree for our residents that may live here and want to have a permit.
So, sounds like potentially more discussion in terms of a selectman's regulation. But in the meantime, this process is out there. We have to deal with it. As a board, we probably have an issue with the 10 days to respond.
Yep.
Certainly have a lot of faith in our police department.
Yeah.
So, and I guess I'm just trying to see here if we actually have to designate or whether it's either or.
I highlighted the permitting authority.
Permit is the chief of police or the board or officer having control of the police in a city or a town.
So I think there's authority already defined when it said or. It doesn't say and. That would.
So I don't know if we want to clarify that.
We're the acting officer of the police chief, and we're also the acting board of the police as well. Right. So in some communities, they might have two separate. Ours is the same.
So it's easy enough to put something in the minutes and just vote to allow the, you know, give the police department the authority to issue ice cream permits.
I think if we just did a motion just clarifying that if everyone's in agreement that we authorize them to handle this permitting process.
So moved.
Second.
I can certainly notify the board if we become inundated with ice cream truck vendor permits.
Right. Local you're buried.
And there is a problem with how this will be approved. I can certainly notify the board.
I'm running down tomorrow.
A lot of people show up in white suits and that's, you know.
Any discussion or questions?
Question.
Yeah, sure.
Do we want to affix a fee to that?
That's a very good question. How does that get done in terms of
Selectmen's regulation?
I wasn't going to say it for the 14th time tonight, but
should that be another motion?
Yeah, we generally attempt to review our fees before the beginning of a fiscal year. At least I recommend that each department review their fees and make sure they're up to date and responsive and responsible.
We would have to have a public hearing too, right? If we're going to assess a fee to this, would we have to have a public hearing? No?
I don't think so, no.
What's the cost of a Corey background check for the police department?
Does it cost us anything? It doesn't cost us anything.
There is nothing.
A piece of paper.
Would you say $30?
What was the fee that we just established for the
solicitation?
$25.
I move that we assess a fee of $25 on the application of an ice cream truck vendor registration or application.
I'll second it, but we already have another question on the floor that we need to vote on first. So, but I'd second that. So there's two questions out there, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah. So let's do the first one first.
There you go.
Which is, any more comments or questions on the delegation of the police chief to handle this permitting process?
You can take the hundreds of calls.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. Unanimous. Okay. Now, second motion on the table.
It's an assessment of a $25 fee for the cost of the applicant of the ice cream truck vendor application.
I had already seconded it. Yep.
Second? Yep. Discussion.
It seems rather low. I mean, do you have any time involved when you do this type of thing?
In this permitting regulations current form, no, I don't. I think that you're running a Corey criminal background check. If somebody were to have a clean record with regard to how this is written, you would issue the permit. I mean, you're not looking at a lot of time. I think the biggest time, and knowing that we have the solicitation bylaw coming, where I'm putting together a permitting process, which a DASIF sergeant will handle relative to solicitation. My hope is to use the same technology for this once I get the town seal. And I'm not looking at an overabundance of work to get it done.
And ultimately, we're talking
what are we going to get, 4 or 5 trucks?
$25 to maybe $100 a year.
Yeah, it's
more of a principal thing, right, to make sure that there's any cost covered, so.
I know it's expensive to do business today, but still, to me, that seems a little low. I don't know, was that something that we did evaluate?
No, we haven't.
But it's on par with.
Like your Republican friends are going to.
Wow.
Or mine will. I can't believe it's coming out.
The towns
Maybe because I'm sitting next to you now, Gary. I don't know.
No.
Wow. What I could,
maybe
I could suggest is we still are going to we potentially could review all the fees if we need to. We could re-review this at any time, correct?
Yes.
What are our other
But if we get a we get an influx of calls this week,
hear that rage,
we might as well have something on the books.
The good human man shows up with a complaint.
I think the fact that we already established the solicitation fee at 25,
right,
and we have to take pictures and things like that.
The solicitation bylaw will increase our workload. I mean, you know, with the amount of solicitors that we get, I see that more of being a workload and financial problem than the ice cream vendors.
Okay. Any other questions, Dave, or comments?
I just have one question. Do we have any existing ice cream vendors permitted to do business in Georgetown right now?
Not under the authority of the police department.
Okay. I think I'm sure I've heard ice cream trucks.
Oh, no, I've heard them too. And I'm never at a location where I can see the truck to see if it has a permit in the window. Because I know one frequents the games, the lacrosse game and the softball field. So with this,
we've never had an issue with them.
I would just like to do a permit check to see if, in fact, that they're registered, and that's on my agenda.
Okay, I'll let you do that.
Okay, so motion is on the table to adopt the $25 fee. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, unanimous. Well, that was easy to say. Okay.
How the food truck.
Yeah. Yeah, was that leaving?
Now the actual agenda issue. Food truck regulation. Maybe you can give us a status update where we are on this and what we need to do.
Well, I think that the food truck ordinance, like Mike had said, came basically in reverse. It wasn't from the police department to get this going. It was more of a town government legislative act.
Right.
I saw that the police department was part of this mobile food vendors committee, and just wanted to ensure that whatever our role is, that we do our due diligence to participate. I see that even in some of the Section 7, the general requirements, it's still in draft form for the period of time that this would be issued, as well as the number of feet of any fixed food establishment or restaurant. When we reviewed it as a department, we didn't know if the regulation was tight enough about, you know, the definition of what a restaurant is and what it sells. Example, if the restaurant sells the particular item that the food truck sells, is it going to be 50 feet or is it going to be another distance? It says 50 in the beginning and then it's X'd out in the general requirements. I didn't know what that footage was going to be.
I think it's because we weren't sure.
Yeah.
So my suggestions on how we get a complete document that we could take a vote on.
Well, I think number one, if you go back to Section 6, they're asking this example actually asks for an application fee, and then if it's granted, a permit fee. The application is to process the application.
And why they're very different too, if you look in Section 7, number 5. No mobile food vehicle shall use or maintain any outside sound, amplifying equipment, lights, or noisemakers such as bells, horns, or whistles, or similar devices to attract customers. It's a total opposite to a regulation of an ice cream truck, because everybody knows what those sound like and what they look like. So there's a very of I think the ice cream truck is inherently mobile. That is always moving, versus I think these food vendor trucks could be stationary at any particular location depending on what their application is.
Is the health department required to issue a permit as well for a mobile food truck? Is that?
Yes.
Okay. So it's three fees then, it could be. One, the application. Two, the health department. And three, our board, or whether the issuing authority.
Yes.
Do we know what the health Board of Health's fee is?
No, I don't.
So is this something that we might want to hold get a chance to review deeper and bring any questions to or suggestions for some of these highlighted areas that need to be either reworded or...
Yeah, because in Section 4, it actually comes to the town administrator's office for approval.
Yeah.
The permit is annually to the town administrator's office, so that's why I wanted to separate that ice cream truck regulation situation, because it's not the same.
Yeah.
If I may, Mr. Chair.
Sure.
I don't know how you do this, but do we kind of... How do we get a feeling of the board? Do we want to work with these guys? I mean, we've got... This, what we've got here looks pretty much like the one that we received earlier from Great Barrington. And there was also another one from Scituate. There's one from Scituate. I'm reading it over. It looks like it pretty much rules them out. I don't know if they're going to go anywhere in that town.
Yeah.
Where this one is much more in working with them. And I guess we got to... What's the feeling of the board? Do we want to work with these guys? Or do we... I don't know if I can actually say it, but I will. Or do we want to kind of say... No, we don't want you.
Right. What's the spirit of the board in terms of?
Before we go way into it, what's the spirit of?
Do we not feel that our community is a community?
I mean, and also, does the park and recreation or the school committee or anybody else have any bylaws presently? Like, there's a. You know, do we allow these guys? I don't know if they're allowed on like to go down to the park when many times there's supposed to be somebody else there. I know at the concerts there's people there trying to raise money and sell things, and then you got somebody else comes along and parks a hot dog wagon right next door. I don't know whether the park or rec has anything on that or not. Whether
they'd have to come through us, but I think I've seen food trucks in town before.
There's one in town that's
in town. How's Fat Belly doing it now?
Fat Belly Barbecue.
The health department, is that what they're doing?
They're at the Georgetown days. They've
got no regulations.
Well, they also, I believe, frequent some businesses. As you go during the day, they will during break time. I've seen them frequent businesses where they...
Yeah, but I think
they're on private property, I think, is the difference. If they're going to private property versus...
Well, we've had Fat Belly...
This is being on public property.
Well, yeah, see, some of them guys are at, like, the farmer's market. So that's another thing with the ordinance, I think what you said.
We do permit them, though.
You don't want to rule them out from parking right next to each other at, like, a farmer's market. So I guess you got to be careful where you go with that type of thing.
And according to Section 4, it is approved by committee. Number 1 says the application must receive approval from each department represented within the committee prior to its final approval and the issuance of a permit by the Board of Selectmen. And the committee consists of police, fire, public works, Board of Health, building, public works, police, building, and health and fire.
But see, I didn't quite read it that way. It said by the committee, but not the committee members, I believe, right? Because that's what I thought. Like, will we be able to get a quorum together to get these guys approved? I think the way it read was it had to be approved by the committee, but not the...
Yeah, I read the sentence.
Like the Board of Health.
Yeah.
I don't think it has to be approved by the Board of Health member on the committee.
Right.
Yeah.
Maybe it's similar to when we pass around plans with regard to the planning board. They send it to each department, you sign the approval, and then it moves on to the next person on the list.
That's
with a yay or a nay.
That's kind of how I...
And that's subjective, right? So we don't need to have that layer of approval in there.
Right, we don't need committee in there. We could just make it approvals from various departments.
Do we need another committee?
we don't need more committee.
If
they don't have a quorum, nobody gets a permit.
You can do it with
Gary
the sign
is in
off
charge
like
of the mobile food
committee.
I mean,
have to get a sign off from each.
Yeah, department approval.
We could have our selectman procedure, right, that says, you know, we're the permitting board, and just like anything else, we check to make sure that the Board of Health is, or, you know, approved it, or whatever steps need to be in there.
Yes.
You know, that makes more sense.
Yeah. Committee.
You know, just like we would do utilities paid or taxes paid, you know, a different type of business. So
this one would be fixed, so you'd be approving where it's going to be, too.
Yeah, well, that's
zone. So it wouldn't be that they can drive, like, down to the park and park there unless you give approval for them to do that.
Do we
which
have
you probably wouldn't because of other events being there, you know. I mean, I think you're going to give approval and say you can be on East Main Street at this location, and that's the only place they're going to be able to go.
Yeah, in Section in section four from number five on down, basically says that, you know, depending on the sidewalk location, and they do that, they freely use that word committee too, so it's definitely being approved by way of some type of group effort. The Mobile Food Vendors Committee, they say it every 5 seconds, so there's something there that
it sort of sounded like that what the committee might do is say, okay, how many of these guys are we going to allow and where are we going to allow them? So that's the way I saw it.
Great Barrington must be the food truck capital of the Massachusetts. So.
Well, I think it's still a good just to like digest. Two, you know, only two a year in town, because I think it says it's on a first come, first served basis. So you can.
You can limit them?
You can limit them, and then you can limit to where they will be located. Right. I think that's situated. That's what theirs was more of.
I was going to ask the question, do we have food zones in town?
No, there's no regulation. That's why this is being put out there.
Right. Well, I think it makes sense. I think we just got to
park wherever they want to, as long as they're not violating the parking regulations.
How do we, just a side note, do we designate food zones in this selectman's regulation, or is that a separate process? Or is that a true zoning of creating
food
zones?
No, I think that's just part of this permit. It's not a zoning regulation. It's just, this is where food trucks can park.
Now, the enforcement aspect for the police, would it be a bylaw violation pursuant to the fine, the actual issuance of a bylaw violation?
Well, there is no bylaw, so it would be we'd have to put those fines in our selectmen's.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, well, and here it says penalty of X per day for violation, right. Separate, distinct offense on Section 8.
Which is enforceable by you guys, right?
But the actual document that you hand them is a Georgetown bylaw violation. It's an actual ticket. That's how we handle our bylaw violations now. Someone violates a bylaw in Georgetown. It looks just like a parking ticket, but it's a Georgetown bylaw violation with the specified fines. Just, if we're going to encompass enforcement, just we'd have to encompass that so that the officer has authority and that document is viable for the issuance of the fine. That's all, just to cover that.
Okay, so I guess my suggestion is we need to do a little more editing on this. Maybe rethink the multi-committee process. I guess, is there anybody who thinks we're not on the right track to try and do something to manage this process?
Well, I think we need something.
Mr. Chair, can we back up? Because originally the question on the floor was, do we want to play with these guys or not?
Right, so same.
So before we get to your question, I think we need to figure the will and pleasure of the board. I don't have necessarily a problem with it, you know, accepting, you know, maybe a limited number of permits a year for food trucks. Personally, speaking for myself, so I think we need to just kind of quickly figure out where the will and pleasure of the board is, and then address that other piece of it, I think.
So I'll ask the question, is there anyone who feels strongly about not having food trucks in Georgetown?
Mr. Chairman, I'm not against food trucks, but I'm against creating a whole bunch of extra work for two or three food trucks. Mm-hmm. They're obviously allowed to do it now somehow, because I've seen it. We've had Georgetown Days on the library library yard there. And the Fat Bellies, not to pick on them, because they're great people and they do a good job, good sandwiches. They're there serving, so how do they get to do it?
Don't we do a special permit?
Do we do a special permit for the day? Is that how we've done it in the past? I can't remember.
No.
No, how are they allowed to do it now?
They just show up. There's no regulation.
But they don't just create this vehicle and create the food and everything without going to Board of Health somewhere?
I think the only thing they need is health regulations.
Okay.
Yeah, so the Board of Health.
So health
and then whatever that event is, whether they've obviously...
Yeah, we're usually notified that there's an event and they... Whatever the special permit is for the event, at least most of them anyhow, I've seen that, you know, here's the things we're going to have, and we, I guess there's an assumption here that somebody is, and it's good that we clarify that they're actually getting a...
We could come out and just say, our rule is you need a one-day license for any food truck in town with a specific location, as long as you're satisfied your health health department regulations. I don't want to create, you know, this is a, it's a 9-page document on,
that is sort of what
I think it's just overkill.
Perhaps what we need to do is work on a license. At least there we've got something where perhaps we can ask for a query check, we can get a little bit of something out of them, and at least once we've got a license procedure in place, then we'd know how many. It's sort of like we're kind of joke about the ice cream truck, you know, we're going to have everybody calling. It may not be a problem, but if it is, if we at least have a licensing thing, and we could do it as a 1 day or a 1 week, yeah, that could be our discretion.
Yeah, just a 1 day, that's it. A 1 day thing, and that's it. You know, per event.
Like that hot dog guy that came
But
he wanted to be there every day.
Yeah, I mean,
5 days a week in one spot. I mean, that's what this is more for, type of a person.
So getting back to, I think there's two options here, Mr. Chairman, rather than just, hey, do we want them in town or we don't want them in town? But if we want them in town, how frequently do we want them in town? And that's where I am. Mm. In other words, we're having 10 events in the summer. You know, come in for 10 different permits, as long as you can show that your food's not contaminated and you got a clean truck, you should be able to show up. I mean, I like it that way rather than a committee, and this is just...
Yeah, I don't think there's a lot of support for the secondary committee at this point. So I think it's more, we're simplifying beyond that.
Yeah,
I think the original question is, it doesn't seem to be any strong feeling about no food trucks. I'm not hearing anyone say...
I don't want to see a stationary ones anywhere in town.
I would agree with what Stu said. I think perhaps I don't mind on a limited basis if a guy did set up off the highway if he felt that he could do it and make a business. That I don't have a problem with one or two, but as you said, you don't want to see a whole town full. But then again, if you are having an event, you don't want to say, well, we're sorry, we only allow two. So it is. It's sort of a...
Yeah.
Right. And so then... Again, I think we got to go back and do a little more work on this, which is a great start. But then the question is there any issue with a simplified permitting or licensing? And then we could take it as a vote. We don't have to do it now, but the goal will be to move towards a simplified selectmen's regulation.
One page, event by event.
Because there's things like food zones and so forth, too, that we want to do. We have to do a little work on where our food zones would be and so forth.
But if you don't outlaw or control permanent locations, they'll happen. And this is really to protect the brick and mortar restaurants in town that are paying real estate taxes. These guys come in, they don't pay fees, they don't pay taxes. So it puts the brick and mortar restaurants at a distinct disadvantage. Right. They can be undersold, and you can sell subs and pizzas from a truck.
I think we're in agreement.
Easier.
Right, I think we're in agreement on the protection piece and getting this through. I think it's just working through some of the details on how it gets approved and if there are any other designations that go in there.
I like the 1 day, one license thought process. I'll just throw that out. 1 day,
We should think about if someone wants a summer license. I mean, we might as well plan ahead because someone's first day you do the 1 day, the next someone's going to come in for a 3 day, right? So I think we should plan ahead and say, if we're going to do this, let's just have a plan or a process. So I think we're in agreement on the protection, but we need just to work on the language a little bit. So I'll circle back with Mike and Janet on that. And we'll get it back on a hopefully soon to be agenda.
Before the first truck applies for a license.
Right. Although, I mean, if someone came into town, if they were operating in town, we can enact this at any time and then they're required to do it, right? So you don't really lose out, right? Because if they're operating because there's no restrictions, and we put restrictions in place.
No, I don't think there's any grandfathering involved there.
So, I mean, when we do enact it, and again, it is food truck season, per se, so.
Mike, can you confirm that, as of today, any food truck that does come in is actually inspected by the health department, if that is true or not?
I will.
Okay. I'm not clear on that.
Thank you. Okay, if we're good, we're going to move on to secondhand shop regulations.
Here we go.
Go Bruins.
Yeah, Bruins are up 1-0. We already won 1-0.
Mr. Chair, let's move this along, all right? Time's wasting.
We lost all our fans 18 minutes ago.
Exactly. Yeah,
everybody's watching the Bruins right now.
Including me right here. Yeah.
Okay. So let's start this process the same way.
Okay.
Because that last one worked really well.
This one is very concrete and should go quick for the Bruins, right. For the Bruins game. Back in 2009, we had approached the board with regard to secondhand shops. Mm. And just a brief summary, under our current bylaw, under Chapter 80, we have a chapter in section for junk dealers. It's one page, it's very benign, four sections with regard to junk dealers. And it's really been difficult handling merchandise in our secondhand shops due to the fact that they're secondhand shops, some of the merchandise they're receiving is stolen. And family heirlooms, some of our other local pawn shops outside of Georgetown actually get credit cards. Home Depot gift cards are sent to pawn shops and so forth. So, you know, one can use their imagination how those end up there. But specifically for Georgetown is that our secondhand shop owners have no regulation to work with the police department to ensure that the property that they receive, jewelry and wares, is actually being pawned by someone who legitimately owns it or being sold to that secondhand shop. And what's happening is by the time the crime is reported and we investigate to get potentially that property back for people, the property's gone. The jewelry's been melted or it's been sold to an unknown location because there is no identifier in our current bylaw as to who can come into a secondhand shop. The list I had of secondhand shops back in 2009, I looked at it today, and I did not get an updated list from Janet, nor did I ask her. I was just going with off the top of my head. I have 1, 2, 3, 4 off the list, I think, are still current today by with the, unless there are some new ones, where it would actually affect them. Two of them are no longer in business here in Georgetown. And looking at the secondhand shop regulation, probably the biggest change we made since 2009 on the advice of town council was we as the police were looking for a 60-day hold on property. They reduced it to 30 days, which seemed to be better for the business owner, which is certainly nothing that's of concern for us. And what happens is if you look in section 4 under retention of articles, we as the police can give written notice to a secondhand shop dealer that we have reasonable grounds to believe more likely than not that a specific item is associated with criminal conduct. I have 5 or 6 cases that we're currently working on items that were stolen from people's homes or people's businesses. They make it to a secondhand shop. Mm-hmm. And there's also a protection mechanism here for the secondhand shop owner because the shops that do cooperate with us, unfortunately, when we find out something stolen and they paid someone, until they get restitution, they lose out on paying someone for the item, and then they lose the item back to the original owner because it's considered stolen. Hmm. So the process is not only to help the person whose property has been stolen, but shop owners aren't here. They may not think of it in that way, but I mean, they, in cooperation with this regulation and showing us their books and ensuring who's buying what and where it's being sold to, it is a level of protection for them too.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
So you get a report that, let's say, stolen jewelry.
Mm-hmm.
You get a description of it. Maybe the homeowner has photos, all that.
Mm-hmm.
So then do you distribute that to the secondhand shops in town so they know that to be on the lookout for something like that?
How it happens is there's a local network of detectives. And with property crimes, they meet monthly. They communicate daily electronically for items that potentially have been stolen. We have photographs. Our detectives go out and visit our shops. The local area police departments visit theirs. Other towns have regulations that specifically require they cooperate. Now, our shops have been cooperative to a certain degree, but their records are not as defined as this bylaw would be, so that we could actually delve into who came in, a photograph of them, a photograph of the item, and so on and so forth to complete that investigation.
So that would include a photograph of the person selling the item?
Yeah, in the regulation, which is also specified in the Mass General Law 140-54. It says that you have to name, address, date of birth, photograph, ID, a picture of the item. And what happens, a lot of shops, what they do is if someone comes in and wants to sell a ring, they take the ring, they put the driver's license right next to it, they take a picture, and it goes on their report.
Hmm.
This is from Plastow, New Hampshire. It's just an example form. With they, I had to black everything out, but the person's license is here.
Yep.
The photograph of the item was here. It was a set of earrings sold for $150. And then you have someone who actually has to prove ownership that they traded this in. Now, if that's someone's earrings that were stolen out of a home in Boxford, we now have a lead to begin our investigation to try to get that property back. And there's, you know, there's tens of thousands of dollars being exchanged with these items.
Yeah.
I mean, we've seen invoices $3,000 or $4,000 for one item. I mean, jewelry's expensive.
Yeah.
And typically, it's not just the one item. It's going back it's to multiple. The actual criminals.
Yep. Exactly. And what's happening right now is, I mean, there are shops that are obviously easier to deal with people who have bad intent than shops that do not.
Mm-hmm.
This particular report here from Plastow, they require weekly reports from all their pawn shops and secondhand dealers. They're assigned to their detective division, and they go through every single one to ensure that those pieces of property don't belong to somebody. And then further, they'll actually test their pawn shops and their to make sure that they're complying. Send somebody in, very similar to an alcohol serving establishment.
Mm-hmm.
Bring something in, make sure it's being processed properly. Go back to see if it was processed properly. So there's just some tighter regulation there, because right now we have none. We have absolutely nothing to work with. This is all we have.
So your recommendation is, as we're looking at it here?
Yes, this was a draft that Mike had put together. It was run through town council, right?
Yes.
Yes. And there were some changes. I mean, obviously, town council had some opinions to protect the shop owners as well as protect us as a town. The only thing that we had a question on, and it's certainly something that we can live with, is in section 4, the last sentence says, the secondhand shop holding the item shall then continue to hold the item specified in the notice until released by the chief of police or his designee. In short, what that means, if we find something that we suspect is stolen in the inventory, we go to the shop owner, we say, look, this is potentially stolen. In this regulation, they keep it. I would like to see the item brought to the police station for 10 days so that we can ensure that the person who wants to identify it doesn't have to go to the shop with the police. It would just make it easier. I don't know if that
is that a change we can make, though?
Probably we'll run it by
town council.
I figured as such.
Final draft.
And my thought is that if, in fact, you do have something that you believe is yours at a second-hand shop, we would have to take a police officer, meet that person, bring them down to that shop, somehow isolate them so they're not in contact with the shop owner, look at the item, you know, almost ID their item, as opposed to just, why don't you come down to the station, is this yours? We photograph it, and obviously, it's the only sentence, everything else is fine. It's a good regulation with regard to getting us involved more with our secondhand shops and being able to get the information and data we need on some of these property plans.
You don't see anything missing that you would want to have in there?
Just that one sentence where it says that the secondhand shop holding the item, because what it says the chief of police may give written notice to a shop that the chief they have reasonable grounds to believe more likely than not that a specified item is associated with criminal conduct.
Right.
So it gives you the authority and leverage to say that thing may be stolen, but it says it stays with that shop
with
owner
the
as
shop.
Opposed to taking it, receding it, putting in your evidence room and saying, look, we're going to try to determine if it's really stolen or not.
Yeah.
And if it's not, we give it back to them. If it is, we're going to have to work with the court system as to the receiving of that stolen property and how that developed.
So in that case, the shop owner would have paid for it, right?
Yep.
So this actually...
It has to be some due diligence on
the shop. So this actually protects the shop owner where they have...
Mm-hmm.
Ability to get
because restitution,
money back, restitution, whatever you want to call it.
Restitution will be from this guy.
Yeah.
And our hope is if the shop owners are diligent that this guy, the license that they receive is legitimate, the photograph match, they do some type of cursory background, it's a common customer, it's someone they know, they personally know.
Yep.
It takes out that an illicit deal.
Okay.
So are there any, other than the question that Lieutenant Cumber brought up about the secondhand shop holding it versus the police holding it, are there any other, are there questions or concerns about this document? And this would be a selectman regulation? Is what we'd be adopting
yes.
this?
Mm-hmm.
Are there any other questions
it's
or concerns?
It's already under Chapter 80 of the bylaw, mm-hmm. and the Chapter 80 says selectmen can make regulations.
Right, okay.
Already under selectmen's license.
Excuse me.
Any other surrounding towns similar, anything similar that you're aware of?
Yes. Yes, the many departments that we work with, some of the larger cities have even more stringent guidelines in this because of the volume that they deal with. They actually have someone assigned to it full time.
And the other question is not that I don't have faith in you guys and you're trying to do your job, but mm-hmm. it's always nice to hear both sides. I don't know mm-hmm. if a secondhand shop dealer would want to come before us and give us an opinion on this, but it's I just don't have a comfortable feeling of passing a law against somebody doing a business in town, and they've never. And I shouldn't word it that way. It's not against them.
Right.
It's trying to work with them, but without them having a say in it.
Low input.
How could we just go about? I mean, I guess it's similar to a public hearing, in terms of if we were going to solicit feedback.
We could invite the secondhand shop owners that we have in town. You know, send a notice to them of a meeting to come in and discuss. You could send them out a copy of the draft and. Invite them in to come.
Yeah, they could even mail.
I mean, we did that with the ABCC, the liquor license regulations. We sent all the liquor licenses, you know, the holders in town a copy, and then invited them to a meeting to discuss, you know, the comments.
How, Mike, how long to get legal counsel feedback, do you think, on for that one sentence about who holds the...
Oh, that would be a phone call, probably.
Okay. So what I'd like to probably do is plan for our next meeting. Put the final version, so if you have thoughts or comments, if you can get them to Mike and Janet, final comments, get feedback, and then based on feedback and opinion, you know, move it to a vote if the board is ready for the next meeting.
And I think, too, to just to address Mr. Fowler's concern, under Chapter 80, it's identified as junk dealers, and under Section 2, it says the selectmen may make additional rules, regulations, restrictions, which shall be expressed in all such licenses provided by Mass General Law 140-54. In Mass 140-54, we mirror the requirements of Section 4 in our new bylaw. So there is a Mass law that allows the selectmen to put this into play, just like every other.
Okay.
You know, Mass General Law that has to become a bylaw, and so okay. I mean, we do have that in place here in our current bylaw. They reference Chapter 140. So.
Okay. So we'll plan to do that. We'll have the next version, and we'll invite the shop owners if they have concerns to come to the next meeting and express their concerns, or if they choose to email, however they want to communicate any concerns or issues, and we'll address it next meeting.
And if I may, Mr. Chairman, on the question to Town Council is 80-2 rules and regulations, as they reference Mass General Law 140-54, and we're mirroring that. What is the implication? Since it's not specifically defined in here, and all we're doing is establishing additional regulation, that would be the question.
Well, I think it's a valid point if someone has lost merchandise going to a neutral site. Might be more comfortable for them.
Mm-hmm.
But I do agree. For me, that makes sense. So, all right, so we will put that on the next meeting. I think that's
all my legislative
all your stuff.
Change. So.
Thank you.
I'll leave if you want me to. I do want to thank the board for signing the contract. I'm excited. My family's excited. And thank you for the confidence in the vote to allow me to be the police chief. I really appreciate it, and I'll be here to serve.
Congratulations, and thank you very much.
Congrats.
Thank you.
Good night. Thanks.
Night.
Okay, we're going to temporarily skip DOR for a second because I want to get to the committee handbook approval. So just to recap. Don't yawn, Stu. You're gonna put me over the edge.
There you go.
So part of being on a board in Georgetown or a committee, there's requirements in terms of what you need to know, what you need to do. Janet and Mike have worked towards putting a comprehensive document to help. From my perspective, first of all, I think it's fantastic. Secondly, it doesn't have to be perfect. This is not a bylaw set in stone. This is a document that helps people. I'm sure within the first, you know, 6 months, we might get some feedback on questions and things like that. So we can modify this as we go, but, you know, something proactive, I believe, is better than nothing in terms of trying to inform people what they should be aware of when they join a board or committee. And barring any concerns, the goal tonight would be to, basically we're just adopting this, Mike, or approving to disseminate this to new board, all board and committee members.
Yes.
Right. Let me see, let me just ask if there's a motion first to see if this facilitates discussion.
Sure. Make the motion to recommend the committee handbook for approval as presented, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Great. Discussion.
Mr. Chair, I just have a couple of questions regarding record keeping. I don't know. I mean, I don't think we're very clear on terms of how we're going to execute on our strategy here for record keeping and public records law. I know, serving on other boards and committees in town, that I'm not sure it's clear to an understanding of where and how minutes should be kept. Where are they all right now? Where should they be? How do some of the boards and committees who may not have websites get a website and how to update that? Is there a process in place that we have to ensure that that's enforced? And if not, I get it. I mean, I've been doing it for a while now, so I realize that it's some committees and boards elect to do it religiously and others not so much.
Well,
and then where?
It's an age-old battle.
We've got a technology issue, I think, that needs to be at some point needs to be addressed, and that's, you know, hopefully part of the DOR, you know, recommendations and stuff as well. But I don't know how we address record keeping and public records law in this when we may not have the feasibility to do it from a technical perspective.
Well, somebody has to be required to be the repository of the minutes, and then somebody has to, whoever is that repository, has to chase the minutes when they don't get them.
How long do we have to keep records? That's one question that I get that I don't know how to answer that. Because if someone said, I want the meeting minutes from 1999, and we don't have it, are we...
The Secretary of State's office has developed a listing of how long you have to keep records. But I believe Janet is correct. Minutes are forever. Financial records, some are 7 years, some are longer, some are shorter.
Documents submitted from, you know, at a meeting that are public record, you know, where the heck do those go? You know, because I never see those on websites, and I don't know where that's stored. So if someone, a resident came in with a public document that wanted us to have for the record, not just our board, but other boards as well, I mean, where do we put all that stuff?
Well, right now,
file cabinet.
The planning board has their own file cabinet. Concom has their own. Everybody has their own filing cabinet, and nobody is no single office or person is responsible.
Okay, right. It's not a. I don't want to bring up the whole conversation.
No, but it's a good point because I think what we're trying to do here is this is a big organizational effort. And there's questions of who has the certifications that you've met your individual requirements, who tracks that, there is where the minutes go. You know, there's some questions like that, but I guess my belief in bringing this forward is that step one is at least get people the information so they have a fighting chance to do it. And then Phil, I think, you know, you make a good point. There are other maybe harder to solve issues like tracking or certification that, you know, your requirements were done, that I think is a future step. I don't think this conflicts with those future steps. It doesn't relieve anybody of those requirements. But at the same time, I think having, if I'm a new committee member, having this is better than, well, I'm not going to say better than nothing because that minimizes this. This is a great resource for that, for someone to have. And then we have other, I'll call them housekeeping issues that we need to make sure we're on top of. That is a future step.
Agreed. It's a building block to the foundation.
Mm-hmm.
So starting, this is the first block.
Now, yeah, and this has been an issue that's been, you know, as I was chair, it's been 5, 6, 7 years now and we just haven't addressed it. And I, you know, if we're, as we're bringing this up and we're actually putting together some recommended, you know, SOP here, then we got to address it at some point.
Well, I think especially with the advent of technology, we have a potential opportunity to simplify or organize this much differently than we could have 15 years ago. But at the same time, there's still this effort required that goes along with that. That's always the challenge. So I'm with you. I hear you on the minutes piece of it or the tracking of documentations. But I think what we're looking for here is kind of a first step. We're looking to inform members.
That's my discussion point, Mr. Chair.
Okay, thank you.
Wanting to know that they're supposed to be taken.
Just, I'm gonna, in all honesty, I've only briefly looked it over. I've been rather busy the last few weeks, so I wanted to move forward, but I'm gonna abstain because of the fact that I haven't actually taken the time to go through it. But I do hope the board moves it forward, and if it doesn't, then maybe I would vote yes just to move it forward. But
right. Well, and I think too that again, this is again, it's much more fluid than say selectmen's regulation. Is that you know, as we learn, we can update it, you know, but it's a starting point.
It's a fantastic starting point.
Fantastic.
Starting point. Yeah, well done. Thanks right. for getting that together. You know,
any other comments or questions?
No, I firmly agree with Phil. That's a frustration, and when I start doing stuff looking for background, it's you can't find the minutes anywhere. Probably 80% of the boards in town. They should be right on the website, and that the repository should go all the way back to the, you know, first day they did it, you know, but that's certainly a big piece of project that we need to figure out.
Okay. All right. Hearing no more discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those abstaining?
I abstain, yeah.
Opposed? All right, it passes. All right, given the timing of where we're at now, so I think we might have to push off the DOR discussion, but I do want to emphasize this. So this is important to me. I think it's important to a number of you. Some significant recommendations were made to us. Some we may agree with, some we might not agree with. But I think it's important to go through them. There's everything from government structural change to position changes, to simple things like training. Oh, it's oversimplify it. And or there's also things that are in process. So my goal tonight was to kind of go through each one and kind of have Mike give us a status update. Hey, we're already doing this. It's in process. Get a feeling this is easy, this is hard. And then take just a casual discussion with the board of, you know, high, medium, low priorities. But it's a significant amount of information in there, and we still have appointments to go through, which I'd like to make some progress on. So what I'd like to potentially do is on the next meeting, let's see if we can move this to the top of the, I'd like to start earlier in the night with this so that we are alert and awake, because there's a lot of questions there.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Can I make a suggestion that we have just a separate meeting just to discuss this particular document?
Oh, yeah, that would be great.
it's a lot.
I'm in favor of that. Yeah, this, that's why, I mean, this
it's
is
a huge
to start this would be an hour. and I'm not sure we'd get through it in an hour.
We just can't seem to do it in a regular meeting.
Right.
You know, and I'm as frustrated, just as frustrated as you are with all the other information that comes up. Could we have a separate meeting just to discuss this particular issue?
I'm up for that, if everybody else is. In terms of timing, I guess, how about availability for next Monday?
I can do next Monday. Okay.
So maybe we...
Can we start it early, though? Can we start at, say, 6 o'clock?
Sure. Why don't we plan for 6 to 9, Janet? We only have to do a start time 6, but, you know, I have a feeling after maybe 2 hours, but maybe we go 3, that we're going to be...
I might have a work commitment, so that's why I'm 6. You know, if we start at 6, I might have something.
So you're trying to do it early enough so you can't make it?
No, early enough so I can get here and get in.
I know. Yeah, so... if everyone's up for that, let's plan to do that, because I do think I already it's bothering me that we're not going to do this tonight, but I can see people's faces that it's been a long night, and I want to take good discussion on this and not rush this, because there's a lot of important information here.
I will come to this meeting if we have a
ice cream truck.
Just a food truck. A clear agenda and what we want to achieve that night.
We will.
I don't need that tonight, but let's.
We will. We would have been clear tonight, but like I said, I want to make sure we get to this, you know, because it's important. Okay. Mike, any report from your end? Town administrator's report.
The insurance advisory committee met last week. We start the plan design change discussion. We're meeting again tomorrow. So that's our goal, is to have a new plan design in place by August 1.
Okay.
Does that include bargaining unit too? They're in this discussion too.
Yes.
Just clarify.
Their notices were sent out to the 10 representatives of the 10 bargaining units. Only 5 chose to attend. But we're moving forward with or without them. This now starts a 30-day negotiation period. And at the end of 30 days, we either have a negotiated agreement on basically how we're going to share the 25% of the savings with the collective bargaining units during the first year of the new policy. If we don't reach an agreement in 30 days, it gets kicked to a state committee of 3 people, and they will decide.
Right.
So it's a 45-day process. Unless both sides mutually agree to extend it.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
And the septic system bid for the public safety building will be going out in the next few weeks. And then several other bids as well.
Okay. Great. Thank you. Okay, so we're going to see how many appointments we can get through here. So I guess I'll bring up the one question here, and I know for Personnel Board is a joint appointment for BOS Moderator and FinCom. One of the recommendations from the DOR was not having the Personnel Board in place. So unless someone feels strongly about making a motion, I'd like to hold off. It's no reflection on the job they're doing or the people involved. I think we owe it to have that discussion. I'd like to have them present, you know, if we decide we want to have that discussion and really understand that matter later better. So I'm not sure we could actually even do those appointments right now because it's a joint appointment. But either way, I'm putting out there is a issue that I'd like to have that conversation, address that DOR recommendation, and then based on what we decide, you know, move forward accordingly. And I'm neither advocating for or against it, just that it was brought up as an issue that I think it's worth discussing. So With that, we start from the top. Someone like to start the motion process? Right in my left.
Sure. Well, it's me and you guys start with the affordable housing stuff, then we'll take over. Not me or Phil. We should stay away from that.
So, Mr. Chair, I'll take a stab at it. I move that we appoint Christopher Rich. Is this 13?
Oh, you got to go by the yeses, right? Are we doing
Yeses. All right, sorry. Affordable Task Force, Housing Task Force. I move that we approve Sean P. McGee to the Affordable Housing Task Force with a term to expire 6/30/2013.
16.
Oh, is this the 3-year one?
Yeah.
Okay, 16.
Yeah,
sorry.
The year in the last column.
It's in the last column. Where are you sitting?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Right, thank you. Sorry.
16.
Yep. Let me rephrase. Retract and rephrase. I move that we appoint Sean, or appoint, approve?
Reappoint.
Reappoint
Sean P. McGee to Affordable Housing Task Force for a term to expire 6/30 of 2016.
Second.
Okay, motion and a second. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed? Great.
Stu, you did so eloquently. Keep going.
I'm working on it. Under Affordable Housing Trustee, I move we reappoint C. David Surface to the Affordable Housing Trustees for a term to expire 6/30/2015.
Any guys want a second?
Second.
Yeah, you guys should do that. Motion is second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Yes.
Aye. Abstain.
Opposed.
Well, I have to abstain because
you can oppose you.
I wanted the opposition a chance to speak.
No, I don't want to
vote against yourself.
Can we do all three of them together when there's the same explanation? So you can do the next.
I got two yeses.
Two together, if you want.
Okay.
I haven't heard from Chuck yet. I don't know.
Oh, there's not a yes.
We don't have a yes there. Okay. So, I move that we reappoint Philip Trapani to Affordable Housing Trustees for a term expiring 6/30/2015.
Second.
Motion a second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
He voted off.
Sorry for myself.
Hey.
Yeah, that's how you win.
Right. Nobody else usually votes for me.
All right. Cable. Looks like we're down to cable access TV.
Cable. Okay. Mr. Chair, I move that we reappoint Charles Davis to the cable access.
You can do all three.
Do all three. Yes, they're all on 14. All four. Well, there's all four, actually. Hold on. One's new, yeah.
So
okay, so, Mr. Chair, I move that we reappoint Charles Davis, Frank Hauser, and Dan Walsh to the cable Access TV for a term expiring 6/30 of 2014.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? I'm an aye. Sorry.
Mr. Chair, I move that we appoint Lynn. Lutris, oh gosh, here we go. See, Lutriskowski, right? Is that that's close? Now
I think
see,
it's the ZY, isn't that silent?
I always get these wrong. Lutrizowski, is that about right?
Wow.
To the Cable TV Advisory Committee for a term expiring 6/30/2014.
Second.
Motion a second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Lynn.
Aye. CIP, Donald Cudmore. I move that we reappoint Donald Cudmore to the Capital Improvement Planning Committee for a term to expire 6/30/2016.
Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion. Any concerns with his time now that he will be chief?
No, okay.
We're all good there?
Yeah, he's good.
Okay.
He's looking forward to continuing to serve.
Okay, just wanted to check.
He's Superman.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed?
He knows the value of being on that board.
There you go.
Don't they all, right?
Some do, some don't.
Oh, well, you know.
Concom, right?
What are we on? Concom. So, Mr. Chair, I move that we reappoint Elizabeth Lilibeth Weiss to the Conservation Commission for a term expiring 6/30/2016.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and a second.
He's checking the game.
Any discussion?
I guess I'm in favor. All right, yeah, second.
You already did.
Yeah, I did. Got me confused. Second.
No discussion.
It must be still making me confused.
All those
sorry,
in favor.
Guys.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Yay.
There you go.
Have we gotten any requests for anyone interested in joining any boards? Other than Lynn?
No, I don't think so. Not unless I've put
ones on there. We have somebody that's interested in CONCOM, and in FinCom, I referred them off. So there's been a couple of people.
Just curious.
Not many. We need more. We need help.
I see lots of vacancies here.
A lot of vacancies.
So we'll take a brief 10-second pause. Is there a Bruins update?
Yeah, Bruins are up 4-1 after the first period.
Thank you. Wow. Takes the pressure off this meeting. We can go another couple hours.
I know. Let's go. Let's get back into the financial management.
Okay. Council on Aging.
Mr. Chair, move that we... Let's see. How many? 1, 2, 3. That we reappoint...
Just one.
No, there's three yeses here.
Okay. Sorry.
That we reappoint Gene Purley, Cynthia Tardif, and Diane Prescott to the Council on Aging for terms expiring 6/30 of 2016.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed?
Mr. Chair, I move that we appoint Donald Cudmore, soon to be police chief, to the emergency management director for a term expiring 6/30 of 2014.
Second.
Second.
Can I make an amendment?
Do we want to hold off?
Yeah, can I make an amendment to that? If I would offer an amendment to that motion that says with the activation date to be 7/1 of 2013 to expire June 30th, 2014.
Second.
Did I get a second on the first motion?
You did. Yes, you did. So you got
Thank
two
you.
Open.
All right. We have a motion and a second on the amendment. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay. And so now back to the original motion, which has a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Okay. So that's 7/1/13
through
6/30/2014.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Chair, I move that we...
We can do two assistant directors.
That we can do both of these, right? That we move... I move that we reappoint Albert Beardsley, Fire Chief, and Thomas E. DeJoy, Assistant Directors of Emergency Management for terms expiring 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Opposed?
Mr. Chair, I move that we reappoint Peter Durkee, Highway Supervisor, and Deborah Rogers, Health Agent on the Emergency Management Team for terms expiring 6/13/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Mr. Chair, I move that we appoint Donald Cudmore, Emergency Response Coordinator, starting 7/1/13 through... 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Mr. Chair, I move to appoint Albert Beardsley, Fire Chief, Assistant Director of Federal Emergency Management Association for a term expiring 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Aye. I'm an aye. Sorry.
I move we reappoint Thomas DeJoy as a team member of the Federal Emergency Management Association for a term expiring 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay. Okay. So we go down to finance director.
I move that we appoint Michael Farrell, acting finance director, for a term to expire on 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion?
There was some language in this about that. Do you want to hold off on that or move forward?
I think we should move forward. It would be my feeling.
I think it was supporting the position, though, right? It wasn't, if I remember correctly, it was saying that it was combined and it wasn't necessarily to do it separately, if I remember. I could be wrong.
Right. I thought I kind of read that he's doing it anyway. Why don't we just make it one position? So that's why I just threw it out there, because there was something in there.
Yeah, but we're not going to get to that until for a while.
I guess I would say I think it's a good question. I don't think it changes the substance of this nomination as opposed to eliminating the finance director position. So,
Getting it changed into one position would be difficult.
Okay.
The finance director was special legislation.
So I just wouldn't want to operate done, in town without acting finance director, to be honest with you. So that would be my only reason why, Gary. It just, the things may come up.
Okay. It's a good point. Good point. Any other questions or discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
I move that we appoint Albert Beardsley, Fire Chief, Forest Warden, for a term expiring 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed.
Man, none of you guys want to be a fence viewer?
Excuse me. I move that we appoint James D. Davenport to the Historical Commission for a term expiring 6/30/16.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. I move we appoint Joseph Knapp, Edward Desjardin, and Philip Trapani, associate members of the Historical Commission, for terms expiring 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed?
I move we appoint Deborah Rogers, insect pest control superintendent, with a term expiring 6/30/16.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion?
Yeah, those 17-year bugs are coming, so we need her.
She's not coming this far north, you baby.
All those
the locusts are on their way.
Aye.
The cicada?
Yeah.
Aye.
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 Now we're losing it. I move to appoint Howard Snyder, Town Planner, Merrimack Valley Planning Commission Representative, for a term expiring 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I move we appoint Robert Watts, Planning Board, Merrimack Valley Planning Commission
alternate
for a term expiring 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion?
What position is that? I know, Phil, are you still something with that? I mean, I guess, what's the difference in some of these positions?
No, I was, but we had appointed Howard because I can't get there, and to be honest with you, the meetings are so technical that I don't add a lot of value when I'm there.
Okay, so Howard took that over, and this Robert is just an alternate to Howard?
Yes. If he can't make it.
Yeah, participation over there is pretty critical.
All right, so I'm going to take it from here. I move that we appoint Deborah Rogers, mosquito larva sighting and spraying. Reappoint her to
Bob. We didn't vote on the one.
Oh, we didn't vote on the other one. I thought we did. Sorry, Robert Watts.
All those in favor?
Aye. We did. Aye. I had written it down. Sorry. Five.
All right. Aye. So I move that we appoint Deborah Rogers as a Northeast Mosquito Control Mosquito Lava Sighting and Spraying Agent for an appointment to expire 6/30/2014.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. Personnel Board. We're going to skip, right, Mr. Chairman.
That's my recommendation, unless someone else has a motion they want to make.
All right, I'll handle the police department. Mr. Chairman, I move that we appoint David F. Thompson as the lieutenant with a term to expire 6/30/2016.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Now, I'm going to go back. Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we appoint Donald C. Cudmore, police chief, with a term to begin 7/1, 2013, and to expire 6/30/16.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, as far as sergeants, Kevin M. DeFio and Scott Hatch with terms to expire 6/30/16.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Detective Supervisor Thomas E. DeJoy.
Second.
6/30/16.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, Detective for the Georgetown Police Department, James Rodden, with a term to expire 6/30/16.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Master Patrolman Michael P. Gadoo to expire 6/30/16.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, also move to appoint patrolmen to the Georgetown Police Department, Dennis Sullivan, Derek Jones, Adam Raymond, and Philip Klebanski, with terms to expire 6/30/2016.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Move to appoint reserve officers, Mark Anderson, Tyler Duchesne, Timothy P. McGuire, Joanne Vallone, Neil Termain, Keith Diggio, Dean A. Julian, Joanne Ballard, Jay Martell, Michael Broderick, Jeffrey French, Heather Lefebvre, Jonathan Henriquez, Matthew Carpacelli. I don't know if I said that one right. Why is the Italian names giving me a hard time?
Carapalucci.
There we go. There Christopher go. S. Pelosi, with all terms to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay. I also move to appoint Donald C. Cudmore as the constable to begin 7/1/2013 and expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Move to appoint Kyle Schroeder as the harbormaster to expire, term to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Where's our harbor?
That's for the ponds. School crossing guards.
That's the harbor.
Exactly.
I move to appoint school crossing guards Kenneth Woodbury, George Kaminsky, and Joseph Bouchard with terms to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 I move to appoint Michael Farrell, town administrator, as the sexual harassment grievance officer to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Donald C. Cudmore as the statewide anti-terrorism unified response network with a term to begin 7/1/13 and expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint to, again, Saturn Thomas DeJoy and Albert Beardsley, fire chief, with terms to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Douglas Baird as Democratic Registrar of Voters with a term to expire 16? It says a 3-year term, though.
Oh, yes, it should be
2016.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint to the Recreational Path Committee Bill Hastings, Bill Monroe, Jeff Wade as the chairman, Christian Roop, and Sandra Martin with terms to expire 6/30/2014.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint to the Scholarship Committee Kenneth G. Woodbury, Pamela G. McKay, and Deborah Mulligan with terms to expire 6/30/2014.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, Mr. Chairman, I move to reappoint to the School Building Committee. I'll take that back. I move to appoint Stuart Eggenberg to the School Building Committee with a term to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. Discussion.
He's taking my place.
Big shoes to fill.
No,
he seems to be up for it.
He can do it.
Okay.
Anyone see that gun to my head?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Abstain.
All right, so I move to reappoint to the School Building Committee Tilly Evangelista, Rob Hoover, Peter Durkee, Jeff Way, George Kaminsky, Ellie Sinkowitz, Michelle Smith, Kerry Strauss, and Eric Zadina, with terms expiring 6/30/2014.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Abstain.
And I'm going to also abstain because my wife is on the committee.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I also move to appoint school building committee members as non-voting members, Mike Farrell, Carol Jacobson, Dr. Donna Tanner, Margaret Mayer, Peter Lucia, and Joan Laporto, with terms to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstain?
Abstain.
Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint the Sealer of Weights and Measures, Robert Rose, the Sealer of Weights and Measures, with a term to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Deb Rogers, Steve Przemski, Howard Snyder, Peter Durkee, and Mike Farrell to the Stormwater Management Committee with terms to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Sorry.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Jim Demento, John Pingree, Mark Perry, Mike Anderson, Peter Durkee, Bobby Linares, Sandy Garrity, Carol Jacobs as non-voting, and Joel Laporto as non-voting. The rest are voting. To the Synthetic Turf Advisory Committee with terms to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right, let's see, where are we? Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Copelman and Page as town council with a term to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion?
Yes. At any point in time, do we bid this out, Mike, to look for...
We did a couple of years back, right?
Was it a while ago? I just can't remember.
Before my time, yes. We haven't.
I think it's prudent to go ahead and do that sometime in this... You know, in the next 6 months or so.
That's up to the board's discretion.
Yeah.
We have a contract with them for a period of time that goes to 6/30. We're not a retainer or anything, right?
No, I don't think we have a any kind of written contract.
Okay. Suggestion
might be worth to kind of, I guess, review their performance.
Yeah.
And their fee structure and just decide we're okay or we want to do something different.
And you'd maybe utilize FinCom and get their thought process on it too at some point.
So they have no contact with them.
No. Mm-hmm. No, I'm not performance, but I'm talking about pricing.
Oh.
So we did that, just so the board knows, we did that about 4 or 5 years ago. And we went out and looked at other...
It was before
five,
I mean,
5 years
before
ago.
Us, yeah.
All right, don't age me here.
All right, so...
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Okay, I move to appoint to Peter Durkee and Sergeant DeFio, Kevin DeFio, to the Traffic Review Committee with terms to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 So we have 2 out of 7.
Nine.
And they can't have a
quorum. Yeah, we need to get some people.
Yeah, we need some.
Well, and in terms of even if we, what are the options to restructure the committee?
I was just going to say we could do it right now.
And get it to?
Three.
Let's... we probably will have some more appointments next time, I assume, right, as new ones come in?
Yeah, hopefully more people will respond. I have to go chasing now.
Well, so, I'm sorry, I lost track. Did we vote on them yet?
Yes,
we did.
Did they
pass? If someone wants to nominate me, I'd be happy to accept a 1-year term with the Traffic Review Committee to help them out.
So Mr. Chairman, I
was going to meet once a year.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we appoint Philip Trapani to the Traffic Review Committee with a term to expire 6/30/14.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All right, Mr. Chairman, how's...
So I do think next time, though, maybe we can get some input from them, but just, does it make sense to cut that committee down so they can actually...
Yeah, I think it does, because I have had conversations with this committee, and those people, from what I understand, do not want to serve, right?
Vacant doesn't want to serve?
Yeah, they no, the people that were in those...
That were in.
That were there, they didn't...
Yeah, and I tried to convince them to stay, but...
Some have moved on to other committees.
Right. So, Mr. Chairman, I move that we eliminate two positions on the Traffic Review Committee to make it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 seats on that committee.
Is there a second?
I'd second it, yeah.
So for discussion, I guess my question is, why not go to 3?
Yeah, that's my question.
Well, you have 3 already, and if it's 5, you're good, and let's try to get 2 more people.
Yeah, but with 3, you're going to have a quorum as is.
Right now, you're made up of 2 town employees and 1 selectman. You may want some
Keep it citizens. In 3, because if 2 people can make it, it's a quorum.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah, but what if you want to add more?
We'll come to the board and ask for more.
We can change it, right?
But 3 out of 5 constitutes a quorum, too, right?
Right, but if for some reason only 2 people can show up, it's still considered a quorum and they can hold a meeting.
Okay. I mean, they're basically making recommendations to us, right?
Yes.
Yep.
So there's no specific action we have to please. Right. It comes to us, right?
All right, so do we have a second on my motion? No, right?
No.
So I withdraw my motion.
No, I second,
did you second it
for discussion.
Okay. Yep.
So why don't you amend it?
So, Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to amend my original motion to make the Traffic Review Committee 3 members. 3 members. Make it a 3-member board.
Second.
Motion and second. Discussion.
I'd still like to see if we could some public keep it at a 5-member board. I mean, that's a big change going from 7 right down to 3.
5 vacancies. I don't think we ever had 7.
Though.
Yeah.
I don't think there was ever 7 on that.
It was 5.
Maybe the first
year. It might have been 5.
When we laid the roads out.
I met with them frequently about some stuff.
So. Well, and I think if someone really feels strongly, we can add, I guess, if, I just, where this is, my thinking is where they make recommendations to us. Anyway, it still comes through us. So I just hate to see, I think we have to look at all these boards that have all these vacancies and really start thinking about, do we need to resize?
They make them functional.
Yeah, this one definitely should be cut down.
Yeah.
But I've, Gary, fair to your point, it is a big change number wise. So, any other discussions?
So we're voting on the amendment first, right?
Yes. All those in favor of the amendment? Aye.
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 Nay.
Opposed?
Okay. So that carries.
So, but actually, why would we vote on the original one if we've already amended it, right?
Because it was second.
That's true. Actually, we amended it. Now it's now we're voting for the 3.
Right.
So all those in favor of the motion to move to 3, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
Opposed. All right. So it's down to 3, right?
That was
easy. And they've all been appointed. Now you have a full board. Okay. So let's see. Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Peter Durkee as the tree warden for... okay, Janet, you did it to me again here. With the term to expire 16. June 30th of 16, right?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Philip Trapani as the Veterans District Representative with a term to expire 6:30 of 14.
Second.
Motion to second. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Okay, Mr. Chairman, I move to appoint Jeffrey Moore to the ZBA, Zoning Board of Appeals, with a term to expire 6:30 of 2017.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Mr. Chairman, I move that we appoint Dave Kapnis to the Zoning Board of Appeals with a term to expire 6:30 of 18.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Wow.
Let's do that again. We should review it. That was fun. Let's just make sure.
Can we revisit that?
Okay. So thank you guys for
your
usual patience and diligence as we do that process. So our next meeting is Monday, June 17th.
Next Monday.
No, no, actually, I'll take that back. Our next meeting, specifically designed to discuss the DOR suggestions, will be next Monday at 6 p.m., and that is the 10th. And then we have a regularly scheduled meeting on Monday, June 17th at 7 p.m., same bat channel, same bat place, which is here. I'm just opening the floor. Anything else people feel they need to bring up?
I would just say thank you to all the folks that we just reappointed, and thanks for serving, and that if anybody has interest in serving on a board or multiple boards, to please contact Janet Patano at the town administrator's office, and we definitely need participation, so we appreciate anybody that's willing to step forward and help serve on the town.
Great. Mr. Chairman, before we adjourn, I was the one that brought up we should have a separate meeting, and I can't make it next Monday night. I just realized I have a work commitment, so I'm out.
Okay.
I'll do my best to get a change, but
we'll work. We'll work to find a mutual date that works. Then
we want
to see. We'll maybe send an email out.
Yeah.
Do a different day.
There's just no way.
Okay.
One final note is it's passed a little bit, but I wanted to thank all the people who helped coordinate the Memorial Day ceremonies. Fantastic job as usual. It was a beautiful day. A lot of good thoughts put out there, and a lot of people showed up. So I just want to say thank you to everybody for that, who participated for that important day. So with that, I will take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right.
Thank you.
The 12th works for me. The Wednesday.